digger, our digger was a boozy beggar, if you think you under the table. Diamond you can have consumed Wilhelm Friedrich Hegel.
All right, let's get going here. Hello, fellow Navikavadans. Otto Excelsior here of Navikavada.org. We are here with Navikavada's own main spiritual source, Panavasa Bhikkhu, of points west. And today we're going to be talking about a person everyone's been talking about lately. We're going to be talking about George Wilhelm Friedrich Hegel. Hegel is considered by many people to be one of the most influential philosophers in the world today. However, other people don't feel that that's necessarily an accurate description. Now, our friend Panavasa is someone who is probably the only person I've ever met who has actually read Hegel's Phenomenology of Spirit. So let me just start off with a little description. I've got the Wikipedia description of this book here. And it says here that the book can be translated as the Phenomenology of Spirit or the Phenomenology of Mind, and that Hegel himself described the work as an exposition of the coming to be of knowledge through a necessary self-origination and dissolution of the various shapes of spirit as stations on the way through which spirit becomes pure knowledge. This book marked a significant development in German idealism after Immanuel Kant, and basically goes on to say that it's had a profound effect on Western philosophy. So, honored Panavasa, will you just give us an idea, first of all, of what you thought he was trying to do with this book?
Hegel, with that book, he just tried to lay out a logically necessary progression, starting with just pure being or just absolute elemental simplicity up to the development of the zenith of human civilization, which he considered to be early 19th century German civilization.
Which was, of course, the era he was living in himself. So
Yeah. He thought that they had reached the peak at that point.
So so I guess by implication, any change would be of necessity a change for the worse.
If you're at the peak. I don't know what he had in mind was going to come after that, if anything. I don't think he even got to that, or if he did, it was it didn't register, because by the time I got to the end of his book, it's just like forcing myself just out of sheer stubbornness to
sheer bloody-mindedness.
Yeah, because it's extremely difficult to understand, and you really have to like try to you have to work at it to follow along.
Right.
Because it's completely abstract. He's not talking about anything in particular, really. So, like, obviously, at some point, he's talking about the French Revolution, but he never mentions France. He never mentions the French Revolution at all. It's all this abstract kind of, he's talking about, like, the philosophical, logical necessity of the French Revolution, how that is, like, the antithesis of this other thing that happened before that. And he's trying to show, the progression of human civilization as a logical necessity. And it's like it's such obviously bogus reasoning where, it's sort of like in the cynics that are editors of the Old Testament, for example, they know exactly where to date a text at it, because that's the point where the prophecies stop being 100% accurate and start becoming wildly inaccurate.
right.
That's when they wrote it.
Right.
It's a fairly good way of knowing.
Right.
Good way of dating. And it's just sort of that kind of reasoning with Hegel also. It's like, he's like the false prophet sort of retroactively fitting this weird logical theory onto human civilization as though it were absolutely logically necessity. So you could predict in advance the French Revolution, everything, just starting with absolute like being, undifferentiated pure being as like the logical beginning of the whole dialectic that then works itself out as the development of matter and space and then plants and animals and working its way up to the to the flowering of human knowledge, which of course is early 19th century German culture.
Kultur.
And he completely fails to understand a lot of stuff. Like he just kind of barely mentions Indian philosophy or Indian spirituality. He calls it a kind of nature worship and then just moves on to like the Greeks or the, I think he even had the Egyptians as higher than the Indians in the development of spirituality and all
my
this.
My goodness, wow.
Yeah, and like at one point he's discussing like there's the somehow the transition between the colorless statues of the ancient Greeks into like the colorful paintings of the Renaissance or something like that. And he didn't know that really the Greeks painted their statues.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then there's another part where, you know, you got the thesis of like anatomy and physiology, like a purely materialistic approach to the human body or medicine. And then the antithesis of that is psychology. Hmm. Where psychology is going at it from the purely mental aspect. And so then the synthesis, which is like the fruition of both of these, according to Hegel, is phrenology, which combines the bumps on the head with the psychological traits. So that's like the next stage above anatomy and psychology is phrenology.
Whoa.
And again, it's mostly in this abstract stuff. He might not say the word phrenology at all, or I think he does in that case. But right. A lot of the stuff he's talking about, like, you know, the Greek sculpture, I mean, he won't mention Greece at all. And you've got to figure it out. And the book is so hard to read that the paragraphs are numbered. I think maybe in the original German, the paragraphs might have been numbered. But then at the end, there's an editor who's a guy named Findlay, who is like a Hegelian scholar. He's got a name, you know, he's written books about Hegel and stuff. And so he made like a paragraph by paragraph synopsis trying to explain what Hegel's actually talking about. And he obviously doesn't always agree with the translator. It's like a different guy did the editorial stuff than the guy who translated it.
Wow.
So they obviously don't always agree. And this Findlay, the Hegelian scholar, like this expert on Hegel, he freely admits that sometimes he's not even sure what Hegel's trying to say in this book.
Wow.
And it was so freaking hard. There's no way I could have read it unless I was living in a cave, and I was living in a cave in Burma, and when that's like the only book you haven't read yet,
and, wow,
and you got a lot of you know, silence and free time on your hands, then
wow.
I just forced myself as a kind of ascetic practice, almost like a penance, to read the entire son of a bitch. And
sorry,
there were sometimes, I mean, the sentences are so long and so abstract, and it just obviously wasn't really worth the effort even to try to keep up with it completely, because it wasn't, I mean, it just seemed like bullshit anyway,
right.
You know?
Wow.
So why bust your head trying to like learn calculus or something when it's, you know, that it's, you know, it's just, it right. just struck me as just sophistry, really.
Wow.
Yeah. So there were times when I would have to read out loud just to keep my mind from wandering away in mid-sentence.
Wow.
Just to keep my mind, you know, keep me reading it so I won't just wander off in, you know, the middle of a sentence or something. And then as I got to the end, I was forcing myself to read at least 4 pages per day.
Oh, wow.
Grinding my way through it. And then when I got to the end, I was like reading out loud and then just getting louder and louder until I was just yelling. And then just when I got to the end, I just slammed the book shut.
Yeah, I can just envision you out in the forest, out in the wilderness, yelling at the top of your lungs, reading the last few pages of this book.
Yeah. So I think Schopenhauer is right. Schopenhauer, he just invented new words just for bashing Hegel. Called him an intellectual Caliban. If you look up Hegel in like Schopenhauer's the World as Will and Representation, you go to the back, to the index, just look up, every single reference to Hegel is bashing him. He just despised Hegel. But I do think that Schopenhauer was the better philosopher of the two.
Now, do you think that was Schopenhauer's objections to Hegel the same as yours, you think?
Well, I think with Schopenhauer also it was just personal. I think he just hated Hegel.
Yeah, because they were contemporaries. I heard some stories.
Yeah, Schopenhauer wanted to be the famous one, and everyone was like kissing the ass of Hegel. So there's like the famous story where they were professors of philosophy at the same university for a short time. And so Schopenhauer deliberately scheduled all of his classes at the same time as Hegel's classes. And then when most of the students, almost all of them, preferred Hegel to him, then he just quit and started bashing teachers or professors of philosophy.
Wow. Wait, what do you think makes Hegel so popular these days? You think simply because people don't understand him, it's always easier to say something's cool because, you know, or if somebody is very difficult to read, they mistake him for being deep?
Well, I think a lot of lefties probably like him because Marx based his dialectical materialism on Hegel. So there's part of that. You know, he's sort of like a founding father or something.
They probably don't understand him very well.
That's another thing. There's some like Sartre. I don't know how to pronounce his name.
Sartre.
Yeah, I was reading a book that he wrote too, and it seemed like his whole strategy for writing philosophy is just write sentences that are so convoluted that nobody, including you, can really see the flaws in the reasoning.
Sort of like the reign of quantity.
Yeah, possibly.
That went on. I mean, I tried to read that. I really did. But it just seemed like the sentence, the writing style just seemed unnecessarily complex. I mean,
at least the chapters are short.
That's something.
I appreciated the short chapters.
Well, that's French. I guess I have heard that Hegel is famous for his very, very long sentences.
Yeah, plus it's just so abstract that it's like he's trying to get you to think that he could have figured it out without knowing anything about history or science or anything like that. He could just sit there in his room and just extrapolate logically what necessarily would have to be the progression of the universe.
The way Sherlock Holmes said that, he could infer, from a drop of water, a Niagara or an Atlantic, simply from looking at this one drop. But you're saying he basically was like working backwards, retconning, as they call it sometimes.
Yeah, like the 100% accurate prophecies in the Bible.
Now, how far back did he go? He was just starting from actual primordial chaos?
Hegel?
Yeah.
The thing is, I don't even remember how he started it. But the thing was, the whole reason I even read Hegel, or one of the main reasons, was of this idea in Hegel that I thought was really interesting. In fact, I can accept that. It's like how he starts the dialectic. Right. His dialectic begins with the thesis, the very first thesis, thesis number one, pure being. Okay. And then he points out that the antithesis, which is pure non-being, is really, you can't differentiate the two because both are so devoid of any discrete content that it's both of them are just equally blank and, nothing really registers.
Okay.
So those are combined together. And then it's like the only way you can have anything that really appears to exist, there has to be a contrast between existence and non-existence.
Okay.
It's like Dasein, I think you call it. But anyway, that's like the first logical progression. Pure being to pure non-being is the antithesis. And then the synthesis is that for like this world generates into the 10,000 things Tao Te Ching through this differentiation where there has to be a contrast between being and not being. And then that's like the next thesis that goes to the next thing. But I thought that was really a good idea, is pointing out that absolutely everything and absolutely nothing are indistinguishable. That idea I really like, because then it can explain the whole universe. The whole universe has to be infinite in order for it to be absolutely infinite so that it's the same as nothing. That's how everything comes out of nothing, because it's the same.
Right.
So I really like that. And so I wanted to read what Hegel originally wrote about it. And then it turns out that that's not how he starts the dialectic in the world as will and representation. That's how he starts the dialectic in the logic one that he wrote.
Oh,
so he had like two different routes that he took.
Ah, so you haven't read
it. I went through all of that, which was like one of the most austere ascetic practices I ever did, was reading that book. And then it wasn't even the right book. It wasn't even what I wanted to find out about.
Wow.
Yeah.
Talk about karma.
Everything is dukkha.
I guess so. Yet you persevered.
I did.
His other book awaits you.
Yeah, I'll never read it. I'll never read that one again. I'll never read anything by Hegel ever again, unless it's a very short quote. You know, so like the meme quote things, those are all right. I might read some Hegel in one of those.
Yet that idea. I mean, my first thought was, the quote, the Tao Te King. You know, the first there was, you know, the Tao, and that gave birth to the two, and that gave birth to the 10,000 things. Sounds like he was tapping into the perennial philosophy, as they used to call it. Now he was writing at a time, weren't they just then, weren't like the Schlegel brothers had like started publishing some texts they'd gotten from the East, some of the first Buddhist texts, some Hindu texts were being translated. Did he have some access to that, do you think? Hegel?
I don't think so. Schopenhauer certainly did, but I don't know if Hegel really knew that much about it. But getting back to your question of why Hegel is still so popular, not only the Marxists on the left, but you know, also like the National Socialist types like Hegel, because he was influential on the National Socialist philosophy of the man of destiny and German civilization being the superior, supreme civilization and all that.
That's right, the system of German idealism that will only be finally realized in the birth of the Star Child.
Yeah.
Or something like that. So he started the system of German idealism? He was the guy that got it all rolling?
Hegel?
Yeah.
Well, he was kind of a successor of Kant.
Okay.
Kant set up German idealism, even though Kant himself just left the thing in itself, or ultimate reality, as just kind of beyond the scope of what humans are capable of knowing.
Dang and sick, I believe it. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, we can't really know the thing in itself. All we can know is the thing as it seems. And so then the later German philosophers said, well, since the thing in itself isn't even really necessary, because all we can really know anyway is the thing as it seems, then really the only reality is the thing as it seems, which is just ideas.
And so that's legit.
Yeah, like Kant is called an idealist, but it's just sort of he was like an agnostic or something about with regard to anything other than what you can know directly, which is just your own mind.
Almost an empirical approach. Only that which you directly experience can you really, that which you can encounter and endure is the only thing you can really talk about.
Yeah. And then Schopenhauer was an idealist too. You know, will, everything is just a manifestation of will, the will to exist.
But he certainly didn't get along with Hegel.
No, he hated Hegel.
Was it because of his philosophy or they just didn't like each other?
I think it's partly jealousy. Hegel, I already said that Schopenhauer wanted to be famous and Hegel was
the famous one. Yeah.
Yeah. It was that. Plus, you know, they're just competing. And I really do think that Schopenhauer was the better philosopher. So, you know, probably he did feel like he was being slighted or something.
Yeah. You'd be going to his classes, not Hegel's.
But yeah, there's a good chance of it.
Hegel's probably a more entertaining professor. He sounds like one of those fun professors.
Yeah. All the hot girls would go to Hegel. So.
Oh, yeah. And he would do these lectures in such vague, complicated ways that any sort of vague answer was probably good enough for him.
Yeah, I think Hegel really thought that he had attained a higher level of consciousness.
Really?
He had reached like the fruition of the development of consciousness or something.
Really? Huh.
Yeah.
Which would imply that his ideas were coming from a more evolved being, were more accurate.
Yeah, I guess so.
I mean, from his own perspective anyway.
Yeah, but in my opinion, he was a sophist.
That fell for his own sophistry.
Maybe. Yeah, maybe he actually believed all that stuff. Maybe he really thought that he could have just, without knowing anything about science or history, that he could just sit in a room and logically calculate out of sheer necessity, you know, the whole evolution of the human race.
Wow.
Because that seems to be what he's trying to make. Excuse me.
Well, do you have any other comments about the book to make? Any other? You seem like you've covered just about everything about it.
Yeah.
Well, thank you very much.
And David Hume could outconsume Schopenhauer and Hegel.
That was my, you know, I'm getting old. I couldn't remember if it was David Hume could outconsume Schopenhauer and Hegel or if it was Wilhelm Friedrich Hegel.
No, but I think it was Schopenhauer and Hegel.
Yeah, because otherwise Schopenhauer isn't mentioned in the song.
And Wittgenstein was a beery swine. It was just
a Schlegel. There's nothing Nietzsche couldn't teach you about the raising of the wrist. Socrates himself was permanently... You know, I'll find that for the theme music for this. Thank you again, Venerable Panabasa, and thank all of you for watching this video. For more information about Panabasa Bhikkhu and his mission here in the West, please go to navakavada.org, where you will find links not only to our fun-filled videos, but also with Panabasa's blogs, both Buddhist and politically incorrect. Thank you, and good night.
Turn free will on hot one, shiny was particularly ill. Light on his eye, could steal it away. Half a pint of whiskey every day. Aristotle was a bagger for the bottle. Hobbes was fond of his dram. And rainy day Carp was a drunken fart. I drink, therefore I am. Yes, Socrates himself is particularly missed. A lovely little thinker, but a bugger when he's pissed.